Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory, all with great warranties. That warranty part's so important. Fabulous pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee. And a fabulous service department that backs it all up. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. So we're hitting the end of the ability to put your name into the transfer portal. Jaden Dotton, the wide receiver out of Suffield Academy, is the latest to put his name in. We'll see how it plays out. But Jaden Dotton has put his name in. Now, Penn State did get a commitment from the transfer portal, and yes, that said player is now taking classes. Again, I am cautious about talking about him only because I need confirmation on signing, and that's, you know, I'm just trying to play it safe because of NCAA rules, okay, as everybody knows. But they've been able to get two commitments out of the transfer portal. One guy that can absolutely move the chains, and another guy that's a tall, deep threat. So Dotton has put his name in. Marquise Wilson put his name in. And what's interesting to me is that the rules state that the timing of when you put your name into the portal is so important. So take a guy like Dotton, for example. Take a guy like Wilson, for example. I think Keepon Lee may fall into this category. Because of the timing of when they put their name in, they can get this semester paid for here. Okay? See? How it works, how it operates. But if you do it before, say, for example, I'm putting my name in, first day of the portal, it's open. Da 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 da. And you do it before the, you know, before classes start. You're out of luck. The timing of it means something, and I don't think a lot of student athletes understand the timing of the portal. And I don't think this is the last day. I think Friday's the last day. Okay? I believe Friday is the last day the portal's open. And then the next one will be open from May 1st to May 15th. So after spring practice, you've got that two-week window. So you've got, at this point, for Torba Mulba ended up going to West Virginia. Jamari Budden is still looking. Keevon Lee's still looking. Christian Veyer ended up at Pitt. Devon Townley came back. Now you got Marquise Wilson, Keevon Lee, and Jaden Dotton in the portal. Okay. So there you are in terms of how that's playing out. Now we'll just see how everything falls into place. But the timing of when you go into the portal is so important in your ability to have your semester paid for. And by doing it now, you put yourself into that category. By doing it exponentially earlier and then suddenly not finding a home, you don't. Since August 1st, there have been between FBS FCS divisions 2 and 3, so it's all of them combined, 2,000 football players in the transfer portal. Again, that's all-encompassing now. It's FBS, FCS, Division 2, and Division 3. 2,000 have put their names into the transfer portal at this point. And approximately to this point, 20% of them have found homes. That's about 400. Between everything, between FBS, FCS, Division 2, and 3, 400 have found homes out of 2,000. It's always an interesting process. And the process works both ways. It's supposed to benefit the player, benefit the player, benefit the player. But look, for example, at how Penn State over the years has used the portal. Yes, some players have exited, no question. But they've been judicious in the additions they've had in the portal. They are not all going to work out perfectly. John Lovett did some good things, but it didn't work out, quote, perfectly, right? As an example. But Arnold Ebikebe worked out great. Johnny Dixon's been working out great. Mitchell Tinsley worked out great. You keep going through the list of guys where, you know, Eric Wilson did a good job. I think Hunter Norzad has a chance now to be a big-time two-year contributor here at Penn State, getting him out of the portal. Big. Chop Robinson has been a tremendous addition out of the portal. So you go on and on through the list. I'm not going to go through the list of everybody. But Penn State has been judicious in its use of the portal, where they've been trying to recruit as many 3 to 5 year players as possible. And at the same time, looking around saying, okay, where do we have gaps? One of the gaps this time was that, and they knew it going in. I mean, even before the season was over with, it looked like the receiver spot was going to be one where they felt they needed to go to the portal. They knew they were going to lose Mitchell Tinsley. They knew Parker Washington was on the fence about the NFL, then decided to take the NFL route. So they knew it was a distinct possibility he was going to go pro. So they knew that was going to happen. So they were looking already in that spot. And they've been smart about it. Now, other people have used the portal in such a way where they've tried to reshape their entire program, Michigan State being one. And it worked for a year. It did not work last year. And as I think I pointed out at the beginning of the season, that they were a team that, again, you've got to, you know, and again, part of my job, and when you immerse yourself in the job, is that I'm always doing a lot of research, not just on Penn State, but, you know, I'm Penn State, of course, the research is right in front of me. But I'm doing a lot of research on Penn State's opponents. And I pointed out about Michigan State about 6 months ago. I said, you know, it's interesting about the portal. The portal giveth, the portal taketh away. They ended up getting 9 guys in the portal last year at Michigan State. They lost 25. And they had a lot of problems during the course of the year. Now let's get to the Michigan situation. We'll go in two parts here. One, Michigan co-offensive coordinator Matt Weiss has been placed on leave. There's been a report of computer access crimes that occurred in December and did so at the team's football facility. They're investigating a potential crime that took place at Schembechler Hall. They say that Weiss has not been with the team or in the building recently, and he has not been on the road recruiting. Last week, a neighbor of Weiss's in Ann Arbor told ESPN that several unmarked cars showed up outside of Weiss's home in what appeared to be some type of police presence. Now, the neighbor, by the way, declined not to be named. Can you blame the neighbor? Of course not. The search of his home is believed to be tied to the University of Michigan police investigation, according to sources. So that's one. The next part is what is interesting, is that the university president is the one that told everybody that Jim Harbaugh was coming back. And in the tweet he put out about Jim Harbaugh coming back, he slipped in the line that he, the president, was the one that informed Ward Manuel, the athletic director. Okay. It's an interesting situation up in Ann Arbor. It really is. Now, the Weiss thing is a completely separate situation. The Harbaugh thing continues to be something where every year he has been stringing them along with the dalliance with the NFL. And you're talking about a guy who, with San Francisco, for the most part, had success in the NFL. And he got the 49ers, my goodness, to the Super Bowl. And sometimes you wonder if losing to your brothers doesn't sit well. All right. But it always seems to be there. And we all know a couple of years ago, before they made the college football playoff in back-to-back years, that he had to take a pay cut. He is in a spot right now where he doesn't need to take the pay cut anymore after back-to-back Big Ten titles and back-to-back college football playoff appearances. Now, the one negative continues to be for him, they can't win a postseason game. Yeah, they won the Big Ten championship game, but they've lost six consecutive bowl games now. But it's interesting how it played out. It was the university president, which is fine. It's the university president. But the president then is the one, and then I inform Ward Manuel. You know, normally, the athletic director and the head football coach are, hey, don't worry. Hey, Ward, don't worry. I'm fine. Right? I'm going to call the president. I'm going to tell the president what I'm going to do here. Right? That apparently is not how it played out. A little bit different. A little bit different. I know I took up the open by talking about information. I'm getting several messages about where's the rant, where's the rant.
Well, two
and
things.
We will get to the rant in a moment because
there
one of us has to be aware of the commercial clock. We'll come back with more in a moment and get to what is obviously now, based on previews of coming attractions, multiple rants of the day on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
Now Crowell is on Pickett. Just give it to Pickett and get out of the way.
Pickett. Pickett backs in on Lindsay, backs in. Great matchup underneath. Keeps going. Wheels, puts it up. Window good. Penn State ties it.
Let's get out of his way. Matt LePage.
That was great.
It's what we do. Matt LePage, who's the play-by-play voice of Wisconsin, who's just outstanding, great guy, looks at me after the game. He says, newsflash, Pickett's really good. But, again, the issue is there's no way you can speed up Wisconsin. You have to hit shots. Penn State, after hitting shots in the first half to a clip of 52%, went on an early second-half drought that put them behind. And even though they tied Wisconsin a couple of times in the second half, they never did get in front. And that's the only way to do it with them. You've got to get in front and then try and get in front by at least two possessions to speed them up. And they never could. Got a lot to talk about with that game, and it's about general comments where it's not specific maybe to that game, but it's an example of it. Because the officiating is slowing down the product in the Big Ten. And the officiating comes, I mean, it's not always the guys on the floor. Sometimes it's from the top. Oh, good. It's a phone call. Where's this from? Butler. Well, we're not going to answer that. How about the rant of the day? Rants! Multiple rants.
Well, that was a tough one for the Nittany Lions last night. But to kind of go back on what you're saying about Harbaugh, I get it, but I also don't get why Michigan just, like you say, why they keep sticking with them. I mean, because all these things that he's doing, he's literally being a weasel about it. There's no other way to say it, to characterize it.
Well,
I mean, it's either you're fully in or you out.
But why are they doing it? It's simple. What are their options? Every time I hear something like this, my first question is to whomever, whether it's you or somebody else, is, okay, fine, I hear you. What are the options?
I get it. That's probably why the only reason why they are keeping with it. But if I'm a Michigan fan, I'm getting close to I've had it with this point, especially seeing the end result of, yeah, you made it back to a college football playoff for the second straight year, but losing the way they did, not so good. And I also find it interesting that he's back, obviously probably because things didn't work out on the NFL side of things, but he's still sticking with what's happening behind the scenes at Michigan, which is very interesting, as you pointed out. So I think Michigan, it's probably a little too early to say this, but this is something to really keep an eye on, though, because I could see this hurting Michigan on the field next year, because there's starting to be a lot of bad distractions around this program.
Okay, this is where I think that if you're going to talk about the field part of it, they have not been exactly accelerating on the NIL front. And that's been interesting. Look at Clemson. Clemson has not been accelerating on the NIL front. Michigan has not been accelerating on the NIL front. And that's where I think you're going to look at, and that may be the problem. Now, when it comes to Matt Weiss, okay, I want to be fair about this. Okay, this is on Matt Weiss. This is not on Michigan. I mean, unless you've got somebody, unless there's somebody who had prior knowledge saying, hey, Matt, you can't do that, you got to back off on this, okay, that's what you got to look at. But if he's out there, you know darn well whatever he was doing, of what he's accused, you know darn well he's trying to hide it, correct?
No question.
Okay, so, you know, it's a bad look for Michigan, but it doesn't mean it's, quote, their fault. It's his fault if he actually did something, okay? Unless somebody knew about it ahead of time, then it's a big problem.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia,
Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, the best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee, and a fabulous service department with great technicians that take care of the life of the vehicle. My goodness, I mean, it's really one-stop vehicle shopping for the life of it. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Any other rants on your part? It sounded like you had multiple rants.
Well, the other thing is...
And then I'm going to talk about the NCAA basketball tournament. Go ahead.
Yes. I am very intrigued, and I am very excited for Penn State's offense next year. I think it can be better with these two new guys in that we'll talk more about when you can and when they officially are in. But I am liking what I'm seeing. With these two guys on the outside, the trio of the two tight ends you have coming back, which are very good tight ends, and with Drew Aller's capabilities, though I'm sure he'll have some growing pains next year, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't know how you stop this Penn State offense next year. Good luck, defensive coordinators in the Big Ten and anybody else facing Penn State. This is going to be a hard offense to stop now. Really hard. It was hard for last year. It's going to be really hard next year.
The bottom line is you got to stay healthy. I mean,
yes.
That's the bottom line. You got to stay healthy. I emphasize all the time that the team you start the spring with is the team you want to end the spring with. Oh, and by the way, the team you start preseason with is the team you need to end preseason with. That's the bottom line. If you can stay healthy, they have the capability of doing exactly what we're talking about here. But what was your other rant? You were ready to really go after somebody fierce, I could tell.
No, that was the other. That was the other two things that I had for today. The only, I guess, one other. It's a small thing. It's minor, but I've been thinking about this, and if the Eagles were to win Saturday, I have had a change of heart. I won't be as disappointed if the Cowboys beat the 49ers and the Eagles face the Cowboys in the NFC title game. I've decided that I'm okay with it and would probably rather that, because I think it would still be a better matchup. And if the Eagles were to lose to the Cowboys go to the Super Bowl, well, then we'll deal with it then. But I've had a change of heart in that. If the Cowboys get destroyed by San Francisco, I'll still laugh at them, but I won't be as disappointed if they win, if the Eagles win. If the Eagles lose, then all bets are off. I don't care. So I've had that change of heart. I thought I'd share that with you. But on to the NCAA tournament.
I'm just trying to figure out how relieved I am. All right.
Oh, my almighty!
Okay. The NCAA. I'm sorry, not the NCAA. The select committee in making its recommendations. And I brought this up a couple of weeks ago, but now I want to really dig in a little bit on this for a moment. Wants to increase the number of schools, the percentage of schools that make it to postseason to 25%. 25% for every sport. So 25% of women's soccer, 25% of softball, 25% of, right? See where I'm going here? Which then in turn means 25% of the NCAA men's basketball tournament, women's basketball tournament as well, but, you know, the men's basketball tournament is the money generator. Right now you have 68 schools. I think the women are at 68, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, 68, and Dave Jones, to his credit, from the Patriot News, wrote a great column about this. It was something I was going to talk about anyway. But then it turned out Dave wrote the column, and with everything that's been going on, and I'm going to get to the basketball game in a moment, you know, probably in the next half hour. But I wanted to get to this topic now. And the reason I wanted to get to this topic now is there seems to be more and more this feeling in sports, and this is something we've discussed before, that more is more. Look at the NFL playoffs this past weekend. We're now up to 14 playoff teams. We now have only one team that gets a bye. That's fine. And we have Super Wild Card weekend in 6 games. Okay. It turned out that over the weekend, the ratings were good, but they're down 4% from last year. They averaged about 29 million viewers, which is excellent. That's higher than 2 years ago, down 4% from last year, but still really good. Okay? But every time we turn around, it's more, 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 more. Now, are there times where I think you need to have more? College football is a good example. It's difficult. But when you're talking about 4 teams in the NCAA football semifinals, okay, which means that is the tournament. So the tournament consists of 3% of all the schools. 3%. By expanding to 12, you're going to get it up to 9%. Now, 25% football, it's a little too big. It's a little too big. And you're talking at that point, 30 plus schools would make up 25%. So this proposal is not around that. And when you sit there and you look at expanding the NCAA. Let's just go with the men's tournament for a moment. From 68 to 25% gets you at 91, all right? There's 363 teams, so it's going to be 91. And let's face it, you have to round it to something that works. So guess what number works in terms of rounding? 96. Obviously, I broadcast for a program where in my 41 seasons, Penn State's made it 4 times. I felt strongly, there are certain years that I felt strongly that Penn State should have made it, but because of the label Penn State and not the deepest of basketball traditions, they were left out. I felt the 1990 team was an NCAA tournament team that I did. I felt that the 2009 team was an NCAA tournament team. Oh, their schedule, oh, blah, blah, blah. Cut me a break. You're playing in 2/3 of your schedules against the Big Ten. Really? Your schedule was that bad? Really? Right? And I thought the 2018 team was definitely an NCAA tournament team. Well, those two teams ended up winning. Now that you're talking about, now would, and
a proposal like this benefit Penn State? Yes, of course it would. Right? No question. But that doesn't mean, even though it would benefit something I'm doing and would benefit a program that I'm attached to, doesn't mean I think it's the best way overall to go. You know, Penn State, especially, you know, I tell you right now, Mike is good enough to get this program into the 68 with what he's doing. You can, you know, he's good enough to get Penn State to earn its way in. And I firmly believe that. There's a point where more is not more. Sometimes less is more. The meaning of it. Now, college football needed to expand. That did need to expand. You know, and I know that benefits Penn State as well, but it did need to expand. It's, you know, when we had Jim Delaney on the show when he was commissioned, we had Jim on the show, I think, what, three or four different times we had him on. And I made the comment to him one day. I said, Jim, I know how hard it was for you to get two. And he's just started laughing. He says, I'm glad you realized that. And it was hard to get two. Yeah, it was also difficult. To get to four. Well, now you get this idea of 12, and I think the idea is probably going to get to 16 once they open up the TV contracts. Okay, football is different, but there's also a physicality to it. We're going to see how the attrition rate plays out in something like that, because you would be playing more games in a very physical sport. But college basketball, you think of the great moments in college basketball. Because you have 68, I was there in Philadelphia when Florida Gulf Coast beat Georgetown. Holy, what a moment that was. It was great. Oh, and by the way, it was the same bracket that included, it was the same grouping of teams where Duke played that day. So you got to see Duke play. Great. They won their opening game. You got to see Creighton with Doug McDermott play. Oh, that was great. And then you got to see the upset. Florida Gulf Coast beat Georgetown. And the building, the entire building, except for the section of Georgetown fans, rooting for Florida Gulf Coast. It was phenomenal. We got to watch St. Peter's last year get to the Elite Eight. We saw VCU and George Mason both make the Final Four. So there's something about 68, and we've seen Bucknell win in the tournament, right? How great was it when Bucknell won in the tournament?
Yeah, that was nuts. We'll never forget that.
Okay, but Bucknell won in the tournament, and everybody remembers it, right? That's what makes this tournament magical, that you've got the North Carolinas, the Kentuckys, right? The Dukes, the you know, team like Kansas, all the way across, right? You've got the Blue Bloods that are doing their deal. And then you've got, quote, the middle guy, Gonzaga, the little guy, Bucknell, winning. And people remember it. Sometimes they remember the upsets more than they want. They remember the Final Four. That's what makes the tournament. That's captured the imagination. At 96, do you still have that?
Absolutely not.
Right. Now, does it benefit the program I broadcast for and gives them more room to get in? Of course it does. Of course it does. Penn State's had some very good teams that would have, in a 96 team field, would make it. But I think with this guy, they're going to make this. They can make this 68 team field. Right? I think this guy can do it. And there's something about earning your way into something like that. And right now, at 68, that means 19% of the schools make it into the NCAAs. 19%. That means 81% don't, but 19% do. And it feels like to me that That's a special part of it, that 19% make it, 81% don't. Now, football, I mentioned having to expand. Right now, by going to 12, you're going to have 9% get in, and 91% don't. So please keep those percentages in mind. So I'm okay with the football expansion because I feel it needs to happen. There's more depth in football than ever before, and there's a lot of depth in college basketball. And with all due respect, are there 96 teams in the women's tournament?
Yeah, that is a definite no.
I'm just saying, I'm asking. I'm not trying to make a judgment here. I'm asking. I mean, do fans think that there are 96, quote, worthy teams for the women's tournament? Does the sport have that kind of depth? Dave Jones of the Patriot News wrote a great column about this. I was going to talk about this anyway. It just I put it off and I put it off because there's been so much going on between the Rose Bowl, between the transfer portal, between a coaching change, between some basketball games I've been doing, the NFL playoffs. So I've been one of those topics I've been putting off, and I felt maybe today was a good day to jump in and talk about it. Greg Sankey, the SEC, who normally is a pretty good forward thinker, right? He's a pretty good forward thinker.
Yeah, he even spoke against this.
No, the one pushing it. No. He's the other way around. I think he's missed the mark on this one.
I would agree. Yeah.
You know, and this is the one I think he's missed on.
Because no offense, I know he's thinking just for SEC purposes. When it comes to basketball, if you expand it to that to 96, I'm sorry, there's some SEC basketball that's unwatchable to me.
You know,
it's better lately because Alabama's been better and they've been in the top five all year.
Tennessee's been good.
Exactly, but that's it. Kentucky stinks this year.
Right now, Penn State's closer to making the field than Kentucky.
Exactly. Yeah. But there's no depth to your point at all.
Yeah, and that's. You know, you look at, you know, and like I said, does this proposal benefit the program I broadcast for? Yeah. All right. Well, but I've got to be honest, but I've also had to be honest with you. All right. They put this in front of me and they say, Steve, I know it benefits the program you broadcast for. And of course, has anybody backed Penn State basketball in his lifetime more than I have? I mean, anybody?
No, senor! No, senor! No, senor!
Okay, not even close. But I think that with Micah, they can earn their way into the 68, and there's something special about that. I think it's been like this for 31 years. And to me, there's something about it that's... Now, they did get a caveat of getting from 64 to 68 with the first four. Now, I'm fine with that. That's fine. All right. But I think this time, more is not better. I think there's just something special about that bracket, something that people attach and start doing their predictions in the office. You know, Sue picks it by colors.
F-O-U-L-E-G, that spells founder!
When he asked us what state Arkansas was in, I shook my head.
Lisa's already told me that for this year's NCAA tournament, she's going to make a bracket with the boys, the boys choose, and face me.
Well, there you go. That's great. Right? And then when, like, for example, Luke picks an upset, he can look at you and say, all rise.
Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. On that, Coach Cohen. I just think there's something special and magical about the tournament, how it's constructed, and I think it's so great. For college basketball.